straight here. President Obama has confronted not only the kind of depression or recession that we all know about, but I think he's also had more partisan blockage than any other president I can recall. I went to Congress under President Eisenhower, whom I personally liked, in many respects admired. But we had a deal then where Congress would take care of domestic programs and the president would look after foreign policy and national defense. And I don't recall any of this bitter partisanship between the parties in Congress. The same thing under later administrations, including Lyndon Johnson and other administrations, Jack Kennedy. There was, of course, some inter-party bickering, but nothing of the kind of blockage that we're seeing now, where some of the president's critics have not only predicted failure for his administration, but indeed have expressed the hope that he will fail. Let me just say this to you. I have never in my life wanted any American president to fail. Why would you want that? Since we all live under each president, who really wants a president to fail? So I don't understand this. This was at a time when our experts were saying that it would take a military budget of that size for us to wage and win a war against Russia and China combined. But we know now that neither Russia nor China threatens it. If in fact it ever did. There is, of course, the terrorist threat, but that's not essentially a military problem. Those terrorists didn't knock down the World Trade Center with battleships or artillery. They did it with these little $2 plastic box cutters. They got them on four different planes, and once on, you have to imagine this. They grabbed one of the stewardesses and put that box cutter at their neck instead of each other. If the crew would turn over the plane to them, I'm assuming something like that could happen. Anyway, that's not a military problem. That's a matter of security we have to deal with in other ways. I tried very hard after President Eisenhower had made his farewell address, one of the great presidential farewell addresses in our history. I think that one and George Washington's were two of the great ones, both generals, incidentally. But I tried, after Eisenhower was born, about the mounting power of the military-industrial complex to introduce in the Senate small reductions in the military budget. The first one was a 5% reduction. I got my vote and that's all. The Defense Department did something very shrewd. In 1947, we'd always call the military department the War Department. We changed the name in 1947 to the Defense Department. It's easier to vote against war than it is against defense. And from that point on, it was almost sacred to take on anything. So the next year, I tried for a 2% reduction. I got two votes. Jennings Randall, West Virginia, joined with me. So the third year, I tried 1%, and I'm back to one vote. Finally, I thought, well, just to illustrate the point, I'm going to introduce an amendment to reduce the military budget by $1. I decided not to do that because I thought it might trivialize the issue, and besides, it would have been defeated. I think what we need is a new definition of defense. I've noticed in these recent deliberations with the President and Congress that nobody has proposed cutting defense. They all say, well, they're dealing with the non-defense parts of the budget, as though the defense part is untouchable. Now, I ask you, why is it untouchable? I told you the first military budget I looked at as a new senator was $50 billion. How many people know what it is today? $700 billion. That's many, many, many times the cost of the entire New Deal. $700 billion. All Americans, I assume, want us to have an adequate defense. I certainly do. I lived through World War II as a combat bomber pilot and saw half of all the B-24 bombers that I flew with shot out of the air. The crew was lost. We had 50% fatalities, at least in the theater where I was, so I knew a little bit about it. Defense. And I know that all Americans want us to have an adequate defense, but what happens is that under the pressure of military contractors and congressmen seeking installations, air bases, or naval bases, or ship building, or something of that kind, under that kind of pressure, pressure. And pressure on every congressman to deliver the bacon. And usually the bacon turns out to be something that the Pentagon has to hand out. And either by coincidence or design, every state has at least one important military installation. In my state of South Dakota, it's the Ellsworth Air Force Base, where we have the B-1 bombs, where at one time we had 160 intercontinental ballistic missiles. Back in the days when I was running for president, I used to say to audiences that if South Dakota seceded from the Union, we'd be the third ranking nuclear power. So I knew that I didn't dare try to cut it down. Because I want to cut the military budget, but not that part. Every other senator, every other congressman worry about the one in their state. So this is a tough problem, but if we could get on top of it, let me tell you what we could do. I guess I'd have to say this, if the Iraq war costs $3 trillion, our Nobel Prize winning economist says, it'll probably be roughly the same for Afghanistan before we get out of there. But if we could end those two wars, and if we could do certain other things, there's a way to get at this military budget. It's going to take a lot of leadership. I suppose President Obama, if he ever sees this speech, he's going to say, look, that's from a guy that lost 49 states running for president. But the guy I ran against got thrown out of office. The late Sergeant Shriver, whose general I spoke with 3 weeks ago, he saw Eleanor get off the plane the day after the election. Sarge and his staff and I and my staff came back to Washington the day after the election in separate airplanes. The two pilots parked them right together at Washington National Airport. And Eleanor had just looked at the South Dakota result just before we got off the plane. She was going up. She said, oh, George, even South Dakota went for Nixon. And then she started to cry. The first time I saw her cry, any time in that long, difficult campaign. And Sarge saw it. Sarge Shriver, he walked over and put his arm around Eleanor and me, and he said, well, folks, let me say something. We lost 49 states, but we never lost our souls. And that means a lot to me. States is whistling air bases. Some of you may recall when Osama bin Laden, the architect of 9/11, when he finished fighting in Afghanistan against the Russians, and at that time we were on his side. We were sending arms to the Taliban and to quite many Al-Qaeda then, but he was on our side. And he came back after the Russians had been driven out. By the way, before the Russians left Afghanistan, they had sent 25,000 young soldiers home in coffins. They had an equal number of wounded, missing legs, or arms. They had exhausted the Soviet treasure. They were dead broke, and the Soviet Union collapsed. So these are things to think about. If we close down these bases, I think we'll have a lot less terrorist impulses as tourists. In other words, what I'm saying to you is that instead of military bases strung out across the Arab world to smash terrorism, those bases are inciting it. And it's one of the reasons we get hit instead of France or Germany or Japan or some other power. So that, I would recommend that. Thirdly, we should evaluate whether it is necessary to continue our long half-century commitment of troops to Europe. Does Europe need American troops? Nobody's threatening Europe, never were. And if they are, they've got treasuries. They can equip their defenses, but there's something they're afraid of. I don't think any of them are very much frightened about Russia invading them. But if we brought out the 100,000 troops that we've had in Europe for over a half a century, that would be a huge saving on our military bills. I think President Obama should call on the Pentagon to submit a plan to reduce the current $700 billion to the Pentagon, to reduce that to $500 billion within the next couple of years. And then over the next 5 years following that, to work it down as far as he could, maybe as low as a total of $200 billion. Even with the $200 billion military budget, that's about three times what any other country in the world spends on defense. So let me ask you, who's threatening us? What country wants to go to war with the United States? We can't get in a war anymore on our territory. We have to go to somebody else's country to get into a war. And I'm tired of sending American boys into these conflicting areas of the world where it's difficult to get any kind of a solution in any of that. So that's another thing we ought to think about. If we had a $200 billion military defense, it'd still be one of the biggest parts of the federal government. I think right now we have the best Army, the best Navy, the best Marine Corps in the world. And there comes a time when we have to say enough is enough. Fifth, the Bush tax cuts for those with higher incomes should now be replaced with higher taxes for those people. Share the taxes, we could greatly reduce our national. national debt. Now, what would we do with this money that we're going to save? Let me tell you one example. I was a recipient of the GI Bill after World War II. A wonderful program. I had a wife and one child at the end of the war. No money. I discovered this great GI Bill where you could go to any college in this country that you wanted to, and the government would pay everything. Whether it's Simpson College, or Yale, or UCLA, take your choice. And the government would pay everything, plus giving you a little cost of living stipend. It wasn't very generous, but at least it kept body and soul together. Now, here's the interesting thing. 14 million GIs went through that program. That cost a whale of a lot of money. It made all the colleges healthy, but it cost a lot of money. You know something? The government made $3 on that program for everyone they spent. Why? Because you get somebody an education, a four-year education. Their income, their earning part of that government, they're going to be paying higher taxes for the rest of their lives. So the government made money on that. Now, why not extend it to everybody and make even more money? The cost of college, of higher education, has now gotten to the point where many middle-class families can't afford it. Why not revive the GI Bill for qualified students? I'm positive we can recover more from that program than we pay out. So that's one thing we can do with this money that we can divert from surplus military spending. Another one, I'll just give you one more example because I could be on here all night. One more example. We tried to get health care in the Truman administration. Didn't go anywhere. Harry Truman was for it, just couldn't get any steam behind it. We tried to get it under Clinton, and that went nowhere. We tried to get it under Barack Obama, and it went halfway. But you try to read one of those bills, it'll knock you out. I read the one that Hillary Clinton presided over, and she's a brilliant woman whom I greatly admire. Hers was about 1,000 pages long. What I would propose, since none of us are going to read it, I would propose that we have a one-line bill, one sentence. Congress hereby extends Medicare to all Americans. This country was in danger, annually. So if I were president of the United States, I'd try to talk him into being Secretary of Defense. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Senator McGovern, for your words of wisdom this evening. By sharing your lifetime of memories you have this evening, you have created a memory of a lifetime for all of us in attendance tonight. Thank you all for joining us this evening. We hope to see you at future Culver Century events. Drive home safely and bear this rain carefully.